Hello everyone, this is MJ with MinIO. In today's video, we're going to be talking about deploying MinIO on Docker. This is just a quick note before we dive in on this topic. This course assumes that you have some knowledge around basic Linux system administration, as well as Docker and Docker Compose and some of the complexities around adding that additional layer of management on top of a Linux system. We're going to explain the topics about port mappings and drive mappings and things like that as we go through them, but you really do need to have a pretty good understanding of that for this to really work for you. And also you can use something like Podman and Docker Desktop and things like that if you want to, and this might make it a bit easier to run these things. But really what we're going to be showing today is going to be on a pure Linux system running the Mobi open source Docker engine on top of that. So hopefully that helps you out in understanding what you need to know before you can really dive in here. And now on with the rest of the course. So some of the topics we're going to cover today are just sort of a high level of running a single node, single drive instance of MinIO on Docker and some of the ramifications around running it like that. What MinIO does with pre-existing data. Deploying single node, single drive MinIO on Docker. So we're actually going to walk through that. Validating the container status once the container is up and running. And then connecting to the MinIO service using both the web UI console as well as the MinIO client. And lastly, deploying MinIO, a single node, single drive with Docker Compose if you want a more of a long-lived deployment. Here's some links that you can follow, and we'll make sure we put these in description that talk about all of the methods that we're deploying today as well as where you can get the images. So MinIO single node, single drive with Docker is an interesting use case. And I'm going to talk about where you might use those in a little bit. The procedures in this video cover deploying MinIO in a single node, single drive configuration for really early development and evaluation of new versions. And I'll kind of put a finer point on that in a little bit. A single node, single drive deployments provide no added reliability or availability beyond the underlying storage. So if you're running on RAID or logical volume management or ZFS or something like that, that would be your protection against drive failures. But in this configuration, MinIO itself is not able to do any sort of parity where if you lose a drive, that there's going to be any way to recover that other than what you have available to you in your system. Notes about this are that MinIO only starts in single node, single drive mode if the storage volume or path is empty or contains files generated by a previous single node, single drive deployment. So you can see the documentation. We'll actually cover that in a little bit. And I'll also link you to the website to get more information about this. So some possible use cases for MinIO on Docker, really a dev test environment for development and learning. If you just want to get this up quickly because you're developing a product that needs to run against MinIO, or if you just want to learn how MinIO works, this is really ideal for that. And also for testing new versions of MinIO to ensure that they work the way that you expect them to, or to test new features that have been released in new versions. Those are really the key use cases for this method. So as I said earlier, let's talk about pre-existing data. The MinIO startup behavior depends on the contents of the specified storage volume or path. The server checks for both MinIO internal backend data and the structure of the existing folders or files. And here's a list of how it treats each of these scenarios that you may encounter. So if the storage volume state is empty with no files, folders, or MinIO backend data, then MinIO starts in single node, single drive mode and creates a zero parity backend. Zero parity meaning there is no protection from the MinIO perspective on if that data is deleted or lost, or that drive is lost, it will not come back. Again, that goes back to making sure that if this is required for you, and you don't want to lose this data, you need to make sure that you have ZFS or some sort of RAID on the back end to prevent from some sort of hardware failure making you lose data. The next scenario is existing single node, single drive, zero parity objects in MinIO backend data. MinIO will just pick that back up and resume in single node, single drive mode. So let's say that you stood a container up, created some data, and then brought that container down. If you bring that container back up and you've left that data intact, MinIO will just pick that back up and resume working with that data. If there's an existing file system folders or files and there's no MinIO backend in the target directory where you're mapping this to, then MinIO is going to return an error and will not start. And also if there's existing file system folders, files, or legacy FS mode backend data, MinIO will also return an error and will not start. And that's as of a version that was released in 2022. Previously, if you're working on an older version, it may have tried to pick that up, but currently, if you're running the newer version here in 2023, when this video is being recorded, it will just return an error when it tries to start. Here's some additional links. Again, these will be in the description if you want to follow along directly from the website, which I highly recommend that you do, as this information will be updated over time. So let's talk about deploying single node, single drive MinIO with Docker. The first thing you're going to want to do is pull down the image that you want. So if you want to pull down the latest image, you can use something like Docker pull, quay.io, MinIO. This will download the latest version of the MinIO container image to the system where you want to run this on. It's also possible for you to choose another release. And this may be because you want to go back in time and run an older release because you don't like running the latest. Or maybe you are running an older version of this and you want to pull down a specific newer version to, again, test functionality or something like that. So in this case, we're doing a Docker pull against this specific release. This is titled release 2023-222, and it also has a timestamp there. This will download this specific release to your machine, and then you will need to configure your Docker command line or your Docker compose file to use this specific container image on your local machine. If you don't want to run the latest version, again, it's understandable. I don't typically like running the latest version of things just because I want some time for it to be out there. And this is also good for version pinning. And it's just good practice in general to version pin in Docker. So even if you want the latest, I would recommend that you don't run the latest tag, but rather you go grab the latest named tag. So it would be like release whatever the closest is to the date where you want to bring this up. And that way, if you bring it down and then bring it back up and maybe delete that container from your local system, if you're running latest, it's actually going to go grab the latest one. And it might not be the same version as the one you meant to run. Whereas if you grab a named version and pin that in your configuration file or your command line call, then you know that you will always be running that version of MinIO. So that's just a Docker specific thing that you'll want to pay attention to. So next thing you need to do is, or recommended rather, you don't necessarily have to, you could feed these commands in via the command line, but it is recommended that you create an environment variable file. This will basically inform MinIO of certain aspects of how it needs to run. So you'll create an environment variable file at /etc/default/minio, as you'll see that we're going to do today, because we're going to run on top of Linux. For Windows hosts, you'll specify a Windows style path to something like /c/minio/config, and the MinIO container can use this file as a source of all its variables. Here's an example of that file. So you can see here that the MinIO root user and MinIO root password are defined in here, so they don't have to be default, but rather you can set these within your system. One note is that anybody that has access to your system as root, depending on the file permissions of this file, they will be able to see these credentials. So you want to make sure that you have properly locked down your system to prevent that, because these will essentially be stored in plain text on your system. And then the other thing that we really need to set in here is where inside the container the volume mount is. So that's an important piece, because we're doing a layer of abstraction here from the actual operating system environment into the container. So what this is setting is inside the container, where will it need to look for its data directory? And in this case, we're going to set it to mount data. We do not need to change that based on the way that we're going to deploy these containers later. So to create and run the Docker container from the Docker CLI, you'll run docker run -d for disconnected and t as TTY terminal. In this case, we'll define two ports to expose to the local system, 9000 and 9090. In this case, also, we will say -v path. So that's where you would put where on the host system where you want the data to be stored. And then you're mounting it in that mount data as we showed in that configuration file. We are also mapping a volume to the config file. In this case, it's going to be /etc/default/minio, and we're going to mount that inside the container as /etc/config/environment. And then we're also telling it with an environmental variable where that file is actually located on the container itself. We're also giving it a name. In this case, it's minio local, and then we're giving it a command to run server console address and 9090. So let's take a step back and actually just put a finer point on what those commands are actually doing. -p 9000 9000 maps port 9000 on the host to the MinIO API port 9000 inside the container. 9090:9090 maps port 9090 on the host to the MinIO console port 9090 in the container. So that's the web UI. The -v path, whatever your local system path, and then mount data maps the local drive path to the mount data dir inside the container. The -v /etc/default/minio to /etc/config.env maps the configuration file into the container. The minus E, again in Docker, that's a environmental variable that you're feeding the container. It will map the environment file that you want to use, the configuration file, which you want to use, and basically tells the container that, hey, because earlier we mapped this configuration file to etc config env, then inside the container, that's the file that MinIO should use to stand up its own configuration for things like the username and password and things like that. And then lastly, the name MinIO local provides a name for the MinIO container. If you don't provide a name, you don't have to, but it's going to give it some random name, and it's just easier to find if you've actually given it a defined name. And then the last command is MinIO, which in this case is just calling a container image that would be called MinIO. And you'll see where that's actually changed later on when we actually go to deploy this, because we need to find a full path or a complete naming convention for these containers. And then the command that it actually runs when it comes online is server. And basically we're saying, hey, server, MinIO server, run your console on port 9090. So that way it comes up listening on port 9090. Since we've mapped the host 9090 up top at this minus P command to the container 9090, then basically the port is the same on the external host as it is inside the container, and you'll be able to reach the web UI. Here's some additional links. Again, we will include these in the description box below. So once this is up and running, and don't worry, we'll get in some labs and I'll actually show you all of these things after we talk about this a bit more here with the slides. But in order to validate the container status, how do you know that it's actually working once you stood it up inside your container? You can run docker logs MinIO, assuming that you've called your container name MinIO. Now you would replace that MinIO here with whatever you've named your container. And to run the above command to retrieve logs from the container. So basically, how do you get logs? If you ran this on your local system, you go to something like var log, syslog, or something like that. But inside the container, you actually have to call the container to get those logs back. And so again, you'll need to obviously replace the container name with whatever container name you specified. And if you did not specify a name, then you need to run something like docker ps to understand what the name of that container is that you're trying to reach. And here's a sample output that you might see from this. Now, pay close attention to this because you cannot take this at face value. This is what the container knows about running inside. So let's say here on this we'll go down to the console line. It might say that its address is 10.0.2.100.90.90. But that likely will not be the proper address because this is the container's IP address that it's finding here. And you'll actually want to use the host's IP address to reach this. So again, this is inside the container, so don't use that. And also it has 9090 there, but you may have mapped a different port on your host to 9090 inside the container. So unlike if you've watched any of our other videos on deploying MinIO using like native Linux, it would actually give the real IP address and port that it's exposed on that host. But here, this is what it thinks it is inside the container. And this directly correlates to what ports you've actually mapped to the ports inside the container. So you'll need to pay close attention to that. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in the labs here in a short time. Here's some additional links that you can follow for validating container status. And then lastly, connecting to the MinIO service. And we're going to give you a couple ways to do that. You can access the MinIO web console by entering HTTP, the host IP, so not the IP that you saw when you checked the logs, but rather the IP of the host, the Docker host that this is running on, and then colon 9090 in this case, because we did map 9090 to 9090. But if you've chosen some other port to map it on, let's say this was already in use, then you'll need to go to that port that then will then map to the container in your preferred browser. And any traffic to the MinIO console port redirects to the container. And then you can also log in using the credentials that you provided in that configuration file. You can also connect to the MinIO service with your MinIO client. So if you have the MC client installed, then you can connect to that and operate some MinIO commands using the MC command line tool. So you'll create an alias corresponding to the MinIO deployment that you have here. And you will replace, obviously, the username and password we have here with whatever you set in the configuration file. So the command that we would run here is mc alias set, and then the name of the alias will be MinIO, And that can be arbitrary, but make sure you're descriptive so you don't get yourself confused if you're adding multiple aliases to your MinIO client. And then the http://// the host IP, so the IP of the host, the Docker host where this container is running. And in this case, we're going to port 9000. That's because the MC client actually interfaces with the API. And if you'll remember earlier, we mapped 9000 to 9000. That was the API port inside the container. And then, of course, updating the username and password here with whatever you've set in the configuration file. Lastly, here's some links for connecting to this if you want to follow along with the official documentation. And now it's time to jump in some labs. So I'll see you over there in the next video.